So there we are, members of the jury. A bizarre and extraordinary train of events. The violent quarrel in a public house between three graduate members of the teaching profession, of whom the accused was one, and three of the students. A particular animosity between the accused and the student Demas. Then the dramatic and quite exceptional chase through the streets, when it is the Crown's contention in an act or a series of acts of retributive vengeance, the accused sought to force Demas's car off the road. Now, you may reach the conclusion that the accused hoped that the car would crash and that Demas would be killed, or at least severely injured. You may think that even if he did not desire either of those results, he foresaw that as a result of his driving, Demas would be killed or severely injured. Now, that is as much a murder charge as if the accused had set out to kill Demas. And it is a charge of murder the accused must face in this court today. So these are the facts, members of the jury, and I will now call the evidence. Constable Jewison, please. This year, were you together with Sergeant Sills on motor patrol in Fulchester?
In the evening, yes, sir.
Yes, and at about 7:45 p.m. were you called to an accident at the St. George's roundabout?
We were, yes, sir.
Were you the first police officers on the scene?
Yes, sir.
And what did you see?
May I look at my notes, sir?
I have no objection, my lord.
A red Hillman Avenger, index number TTB318L, had crashed into the wall of the churchyard. It was lying on its side. The driver was trapped in the driver's seat. He was dead by the time we arrived, sir.
Now, members of the jury, the post-mortem evidence in this case is not disputed and will be read to you in due course. However, it might be helpful at this stage for you to know that the cause of death was established to have been a fractured skull.
Officer, was the driver wearing a seat belt?
No, my lord, though I doubt whether that would have made much difference in this case. We had to get the fire service to free his body. The whole of the front offside was badly compacted.
Yes, I see. Thank you.
Now, were there any other persons in the car, Constable?
No, sir. The two other occupants, who identified themselves as Chris Penniston and Peter Tukes, had managed to get out of the rear window.
Yes, you were able to establish the identity of the dead man.
Yes, sir, a student, Walter Demas.
Yes. Now, from your examination of the vehicle, were you able to reach any conclusions as to what had occurred?
Yes, sir. The damage was consistent with it having rolled and skidded along the road on its side before colliding with the wall.
Yes. Now, you say that the two occupants of the car were also at the scene of the accident. Was anyone else there?
Yes, sir, the accused. He ran up shortly after we arrived on the scene.
Yes, did you have a conversation with him?
Yes, sir. He said, "You're quick, I've only just reported it." I said, "Did you see what happened?" He said, "I don't know, he just went out of control."
Yes, now, did either of the passengers in the Hillman take any part in this conversation?
Yes, sir. Penniston said, "He bloody knows all right, he caused the whole thing." The accused said, "I was just trying to overtake when he went out of control."
Did you then have some further conversation during which the accused was not present?
Yes, sir.
Yes, and as a result of that, did you then examine the accused's car and the car of the deceased?
Yes, sir. The accused's car was a white Mini, index number FYC137C. There was fresh accident damage on the near side of the front. The near side headlight was broken, and the grille and near side front wing were extensively damaged. There was also superficial damage down the whole of the near side, with traces of red paint adhering to it.
Yes, now, members of the jury, the forensic evidence in this case is also agreed by the defence, and that red paint was found to have come from the deceased's car. Now, Constable Jewison, what did you find when you examined the deceased's car?
Severe accident damage to the offside rear. That's as well as what I've already described. And traces of white paint there and alongside the offside of the vehicle.
Yes, and that white paint had come from the accused's car.
Oh, yes, sir.
Yes. So it's quite plain that these two vehicles had been in collision.
Yes, sir. Probably twice.
Yes, I see. Could the constable be shown Exhibit 1, please? Now, constable, do these photographs show the vehicles you've just described to us?
Yes, sir.
Could he be shown Exhibit 2, please? Constable, is this a sketch plan you made at the scene of the accident, showing where the red Hillman ended up and showing the Red Hall and St. George's roundabouts?
Yes, sir.
What is the distance between these two roundabouts, Constable?
It's on the plan, sir. 380 yards.
Oh, yes. Thank you. Now, lastly, Constable, will you just tell us the road conditions that night and the mechanical condition of the two cars?
The weather was fine, sir. The road dry. It was light and visibility was perfect.
Yes, and the condition of the cars?
They were examined, sir. They were mechanically sound before the crash, that is.
Yes, of course. Yes, thank you, Constable.
The Constable, it was Mr. Watson who first reported the accident, was it not, from a garage midway between the two roundabouts?
Yes, sir.
And is it right that you administered a breath test to Mr. Watson?
Yes, sir.
And it proved negative?
Positive, sir, but within the limit.
Thank you, officer.
Constable, can you just confirm something that's not disputed? Analysis of the deceased's blood show that he also did not have an excess of alcohol in his blood.
I can, yes, sir.
Yes, thank you, Constable. My lord?
I have no questions. Thank you, Constable.
I now call Robert Stanley Manning. What is your full name?
Robert Stanley Manning.
And where do you live?
25 Tor Hill, Fulchester.
Yes, and you are the head of Department of General Studies, Bedsley College of Further Education.
Yes.
Now, Mr. Manning, on the evening of May the 8th this year, were you, together with the accused and a Miss Amto, in the Wellington Inn pub? That is the Wellington Inn in Brewer Street.
Yes. Well, Bernard had been off for an interview and he'd got the job, and Carol, well, that is Miss Amto, and I thought it would be nice to buy him a drink to celebrate.
Yes, I see. Now, you knew the deceased, Walter Dimmis.
Of course, yes.
Had you had any contact with him that day?
Oh, indeed I had. There'd been a bit of a row, and I'd arranged for him to see the principal, and, you know, I was hanging around there in the office waiting for him to come back and see me and tell me what had gone off and so on, and, I was just there waiting in the office, and then Bernard came back.
Yes, why had you arranged for him to see the principal?
Dimmis was a difficult student. You know, he used to cut lectures, and he was generally lacking in discipline. We'd had a lot of trouble with him like that, and that was why I'd sent him up to see the boss, you know, the principal.
Yes.
Well, it was very serious because the exams weren't all that far away.
Yes, I see. Now, will you tell the jury what happened that evening after you'd all sat down there in the Wellington Inn?
Well, he hadn't been there above a few minutes when Dimmis and two other students walked in. That was Tewkes and Peniston. And I stood up to ask Dimmis, how it got on, and he just, he shouted something at me and just sort of waved me away.
Yes, now you say he shouted something. What did he shout?
He said, "You've done enough damage for one day, you bastards."
So he said this to all three of you?
Oh, yes.
Did you ever find out the reason for this outburst?
It turned out that he'd been to see the principal, and he'd given up his place at the college. He hadn't been sacked or anything. He just packed it in after some sort of quarrel or something. I suppose he meant that he blamed us for all this.
Mm. Yes. Now, how did the accused react to this? Did he appear crestfallen?
He didn't say so, no.
No. And did Miss Amto?
No. Yeah.
Did she seem pleased?
No, I wouldn't say that, no.
Did Dimmis speak to her?
Yes.
Yes, what did he say?
He called her a whore.
Yes. Can you remember the exact words?
He said, "You're laughing now, you whore, aren't you?"
Yes. And then what happened?
Oh, well, they... Demis was just sipping at his beer, and he, he took the glass away from his lips and sort of jerked it over us. Most of it went on me, but some went on Carol.
Yes. Did anything happen between the insult to Miss Amptill and the throwing of the beer?
Bernard called him rubbish. Mm. He said, "You're nothing but rubbish, Demis, and the place is well shot of you."
Yes, and what happened after the accused called Demis rubbish?
Well, they all started a slanging match. I told Bernard to let it rest.
Yes. Did he?
No, well, you... See, Bernard is very quick to rouse. You know, he's got a very hot temper.
Yes.
Well, he was being provoked the whole time. Mm.
Did Miss Amptill let it rest?
No.
She joined in?
Well, she took some part, yes.
Mm. So he was a 19-year-old student, no doubt. A bit distraught, being attacked by two members of your staff. And you, the head of department, what did you have to say to them all?
Well, I told them to leave it be.
Yes.
Well, it's best left. I mean, you only make it worse by arguing.
Did they?
No.
Yeah. Did you see how it all ended?
Yes, Demis and the other two walked out.
Yes. And Watson?
What? He followed shortly after.
Yes. Did you?
No, I stayed.
Thank you, Mr. Manning.
Mr. Manning, the slanging match between the two men, that wasn't just an exchange of insults, was it? He was trying to get them to leave.
Yeah, I suppose so, yes.
And if Mr. Watson disregarded your good advice, it was because he had a better plan, that the parties should separate, go their ways.
Well, yes.
You said that you asked Mr. Watson to let it rest. Didn't you think to ask the students to do the same?
Well, one gets nowhere by merely asking.
They might have complied with your advice.
No, one wouldn't have gained very much. No, Bernard feels that one should demand certain standards from the students.
And you don't?
Not in so many words, no.
Really? Yes?
No more questions, my lord.
Mr. Manning, it has been suggested that the accused was trying to get Demis to leave the pub. What form of words did he use? Did he say, in as many words, "Well, I'd like you to leave here now. This is a matter we can discuss at the college another time."
Not in those words.
No. What did he say?
Well, Bernard is very sharp-tongued. I mean, everybody understands that about him.
Yes. Well, Mr. Manning, will you tell the court what he said?
He said, "Things like you live under stones."
And?
Why don't you get out and crawl back down your sewer, you vermin?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Manning. Miss Amptill, were you a lecturer in charge of part of the A-level English course?
Yes.
Yes. And that was a responsibility you shared with the accused. He organised one section of the course and you the other.
Yes.
Yes. Could you just speak a little louder, Miss Amptill, for his lordship and the jury?
Yes, I'm sorry. Is that any better?
Yes, that's much better. Thank you. Now, you're a graduate, I believe, Miss Amptill. Will you tell the court when you left university?
In 1973.
Yes. And the appointment at Betts Lane, that was your first post?
Yes.
Good. Now, Miss Amptill, what did you make of Walter Demis? Was he a good student of yours?
Well, I'm not really qualified to judge. I was very inexperienced, and I'm not teaching anymore.
Yes, but you can perhaps say what you thought about him then.
Well, academically, he was hopeless. He had no chance of ever passing the exam. He had a terrible attendance record and a history of falling out with the authorities. I don't mean just me. He seemed to like breaking rules, just for the sake of it. He was very hard for staff to cope with.
Yes. Was he particularly difficult with you?
Oh, no, he was difficult with everyone.
Yes. Well, did he cause you more trouble than most of the other students?
Well, yes. For some reason, he seemed to want to make life difficult for me. Because I was new and shy, but it was my first job, and because he'd found out about my daughter.
What did he find out about your daughter?
I have a daughter of three. The father doesn't live with this. But Demis found this out.
Yes, and how did he react to this?
He thought I was fair game. Something you get used to.
Fair game, so what shall we say? Did Demis make a pass at you?
He tried to once. At the college disco last Christmas, he tried to put his arm around me and so on and suggested that he come home with me. It just wasn't done in a very aware way. Well, he thought he had the right and that upset me. It's like that.
Yes. Did you tell anyone about this?
Bernard.
The accused, yes. And did he take any action?
He told me he spoke to Demis the next day. It wasn't just being groped. I was very insecure about teaching altogether, and Demis unsettled me. I was grateful to Bernard.
Yes. Now, this was at Christmas. Did your relationships then improve between with the student Demis? Did they get any worse?
From then on, Demis made out that Bernard was having an affair with me. He spread it round college.
Yes. Did you at any time ever have a conversation with the accused about the rumours that Demis was spreading around?
Yes.
Yes. And he knew about it then. Did it anger him?
Yes. His marriage was in difficulty and it didn't help.
Yes, I see. Thank you. Now, I'd like to take you back, if I may, to the evening of May the 8th last, to the Wellington pub. You were sitting quietly having a drink with Mr. Manning and the accused when Demis came in with the other two students, Penistone and Tukes.
Yes. Well, Bob got up straight away and asked him how he got on with Mr. Rogers.
That's a principal of the college. Yes. And did Demis reply?
Yes, he said, "You've done enough damage for one day, you bastards."
Yes. Now, will you now tell the court what had caused the principal to call Demis to see him that day?
Lectures were compulsory, but Demis skipped many of mine. Well, then I asked him for an essay that was overdue on a text. Oh, Antony and Cleopatra. Well, he did eventually give it to me, and it was, well, it was just rubbish. You know, feeble jokes and so on. I didn't know what to do. Well, telling him was no good. You couldn't tell him anything. So in the end, I passed the essay on to Bob Manning with a note on attendances, and he sent it up to the principal.
Yes, well, that seems quite clear. Now, did the accused have any part to play in all this?
Yes, well, Bernard read the essay and agreed and wrote Bob a separate note.
Yes, now, did you ever see that note?
I've seen it since.
Yes. May the witness be shown Exhibit 5, please. Is that the note, Miss Amto?
Yes.
Yes. Now, members of the jury, you will see from your own copies that it says, Bob, this is Carol's golden chance to nail him, and it was signed B.W. Now, Miss Amto, when you heard that night in the Wellington Inn that Demis was going to leave the college, how did you react?
I'm afraid I laughed. Well, it was relief as much as anything. I just about had enough of him, and I was glad he was going.
Yes. And what did Demis do when you laughed?
He called me a whore.
Yes, and what followed then? An exchange?
Yes.
Between whom?
Demis and Bernard, mainly. Demis kept saying he'd been victimised, and Bernard was telling him not to be so ridiculous.
Yes. Did Demis say anything personal?
He said things like, since Bernard and I were having an affair, it was no wonder we'd cooked it all up between us, and a lot about what it would be like to sleep with Bernard and how he pitied me. That sort of thing. Well, that's how I got drawn in.
Yes. Now, the college rumour, there was no truth to these allegations, was there?
Oh, none. Of course there wasn't. He was only saying it because it would needle Bernard, can't you see? Bernard was trying to save his marriage, and Demis just knew how to needle him, how to drive him wild with anger.
Yes. So Watson was angered by these slanders. He didn't just treat them with the contempt they deserved.
Bernard had wanted to sleep with me, and I'd put him off.
I see. Now, what happened eventually?
Bernard said something like, vermin like you live under stones, go away and crawl into your sewer. Well, the others were laughing and jeering. Then they just walked out. They'd said some terrible things, but Bernard was white with anger, and he said, I can't just leave it like this. I'm going to finish the bastard. I know what he meant.
Yes, but will you just tell his lordship what happened?
He and I went out to the steps of the pub. Demis was driving towards us through the car park. He stopped opposite Bernard's car. The others were shouting and jeering, and then Demis just rammed Bernard's car, deliberately rammed it. Well, the others drove away, and, well, Bernard ran to his car and got in and followed after them.
Yes. Was he a long way behind them?
No, he wasn't.
No, no. Wasn't. Now, you and Mr. Manning, what were you doing?
Well, Bob was still in the pub. I ran to the car when Bernard got in it, but the door wouldn't open.
Yes, so you had it in mind to accompany the accused. Did he not open the passenger door for you from the inside?
Well, no.
No, I see. So the two cars just drove out of the car park. Were they driving fast?
Very fast. You could hear them whining.
Yes, could you hear the sounding of their horns?
No.
No, so you could just hear the whining of the engine and the screech of the tyres then. Now, can you tell me again what Watson said to you, the last words he said to you before he followed these three students out of the car park?
I've told you.
I can't just leave it like this. I'm going to finish that bastard. Are those his words?
Yes.
Yes, thank you, Miss Amptill.
Miss Amptill, the other two students, Peniston and Tewkes, were they present in the pub at the time of the row?
Yes.
Did they take any part in it?
They tried to calm Demis down a bit.
Yes. They weren't offensive to you or to Mr. Watson?
They laughed when he was going on about our supposed affair, but they didn't say anything.
You weren't offended or angry with them?
No.
Were they troublesome students on the whole?
Not as far as I know.
Mr. Watson had never expressed any dislike or animosity towards them?
No.
So he had no reason to be angry with them that evening?
No.
Where were they when Watson drove off?
With Demis, in his car.
Yes. So when he went off in pursuit of Demis, he was in pursuit of the other two as well, so anything he did to Demis's car was bound to involve them.
That's obvious, yes.
Yes. Now, you've told my learned friend that Mr. Watson didn't open his passenger door. Could you tell the jury whether or not he tried?
I think he may have done. It was jammed, you see, because of the damage.
Miss Amptill, you've known Bernard Watson for a couple of years. From what you know of him, did you at any time think he was intent on doing anything other than getting the students to leave the pub, having it out with them in the car park, and catching up with them in order to get them to account for the criminal damage done to his car?
No. Bernard was a stickler for law and order and doing things the right way. I trusted him throughout to do what had to be done to get things right. He was trying to do his duty.
Thank you, Miss Amptill.
Miss Amptill, can I take it that you cannot say for certain whether or not the accused tried to open the car door for you?
He did lean over. I saw that.
I mean, did he invite you to join him, say, jump in?
No.
No. And he did drive off alone in pursuit of the other car, without you in the car to hamper him or the risk of injuring you.
I know what you're getting at. Look, he never meant to kill them. Not the three of them like that. It was just an accident.
The jury in this case is composed of members of the general public. The Queen against Watson will be resumed tomorrow in the Crown Court. In the case against Bernard Watson, the court has heard of a violent quarrel in a pub between the accused and his two companions and three young students of the college where Watson and the others taught. From that quarrel, there followed a bizarre chase through the streets of Fulchester in cars. The chase ended when the student's car overturned and the driver, Walter Demis, was killed. Bernard Watson stands in court today accused on a charge of murder. The prosecuting counsel has just called someone who witnessed the chase.
I swear by Almighty God that the evidence I shall give shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth.
You are Arthur Henry Ballantyne?
Correct.
And you live at 23 Stansfield Avenue, Fulchester?
Yes.
Now, Mr. Ballantyne, can you remember where you were on the evening of May the 8th last, around 7:45 p.m.?
Yes, well, I was taking my dog for a walk, and I was on the corner of Shipton Road and Walmsley Road. Now,
Walmsley Road, at that point, that's a dual carriageway, is it not?
Dual carriageway, yes.
Thank you.
Well, I was stood on this side with my old dog, as I say, and they were on the other side, the far side. We call it coming up from town because there's a slight rise. Not a big hill. Big enough if you're on foot, of course. But you can see a fair way in each direction from there. You see?
Yes, that is indeed very clear. Thank you. Now, Mr. Ballantyne, will you take your time and tell us as clearly as possible what you saw, and I want you to start from the moment you first saw these two motor cars.
Well, you've got two cars, see? A red one and a white one. Mm. The white one's behind, very close, and they're both going very fast, very fast, and one right behind the other.
Yes.
You couldn't have put a cigarette paper between them. Mm. Well, almost.
Yes. Now, Mr. Ballantyne, did the white car have room to overtake the red car?
Oh, yes, but he didn't want it, see, because one was trying to bash the other. Mr. White was trying to bash Mr. Red, obviously.
Mr. Ballantyne, you must tell us only what you saw and not what you deduced. Do you understand?
I see.
I'm obliged to your lordship. So, Mr. Ballantyne, did the white car at any time try to overtake the red car?
No, sir, not then, not when I first saw them.
I see. So, there are these two cars coming up the hill very fast towards you, the white one behind the red one. And then what happened?
Yes, exactly. Then what happened? The white car hit the red car. Mm. Not hard, not hard at all. But my word, the red car slewed right across the road towards the middle, the bit with the grass on it, the what do you call it, and he almost touched it, and then he snaked about all over the place. Mm. It's a miracle he didn't turn over, but he didn't.
Yes, now, can we be quite clear and precise about this? The two cars hit each other. Could you see that?
I heard it.
You heard it. Very well. And you say the red car came across to the central reservation and the wheels no doubt touched the grass there. Could you see who was in the cars?
Yes, in the red car there were three kids. Mm. Lads, you know. And in the white car there was just the one, a man, older. Yes.
Now you were more or less opposite the incident.
Oh, it's near us.
Yes. How far away?
20 yards.
Yes. And the red car now, the one driven by the deceased, did it brake?
Oh, yes, it braked. It braked all right. It was going along like a snake. Fighting for control, you see. Fighting to stay in one piece.
Yes. And the white car, the one driven by the accused, did it stop or go on or what did it do?
Yes, exactly. No, it did not stop. It braked, though. Well, I mean, you would do, wouldn't you? But it didn't swerve, mind. It went straight. But here's the point, sir. Mm. Here's the nub. Neither car stopped completely, as you or I might. No sooner had the red car settled down than the white car was off again, only this time he zoomed up on the outside.
Yes, I
see. And then your red car is after your white car, see?
Yes, I see. So you say that after the red car had fought to get control of itself, the white car passed it, so the position of the two cars is now reversed.
Exactly. And now your red car is off like a bat out of hell after the white car. Mm-hmm. And no sooner do they reach the park where I'm taking my dog, then the white car slams on his brakes and the red car's all over the shop again.
Yes. Could you see the brake lights of the white car?
Oh, yes.
Yes. Now, what did the red car do?
He swerved around him, he does.
Yes, so now the red car is in front again.
Exactly. But the white car's after overtaking, when both cars bash together and the red car comes a cropper.
By the roundabout.
Yes, rolling and sliding till the church comes in the way.
Yeah. Now, what caused the collision, this last collision between the two cars, did you see?
Oh, Whitey, he clips red on the back.
Yes, the back or the side?
The side at the back.
Which side?
The right side.
Yes, so the white car drove into the offside rear of the red car.
Yes.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Ballantyne.
No, wait a moment, Mr. Ballantyne.
Now, Mr. Ballantyne, how fast were the two cars going?
70 miles an hour.
Not nearer 40?
Oh, nearer 70, I would say.
70, you say? Between these two roundabouts, 380 yards apart and two collisions?
Yes.
The fact is, Mr. Valentine, that you have a vested interest in exaggerating the sort of driving that occurs on that stretch of the road, don't you?
I don't know what you're on about.
Well, Oh, thank you. Did you report this piece of driving to anyone?
I certainly did. Oh, yes.
Did you perhaps ring the police from the call box at the corner of the road?
It cost nothing to do your duty, sir.
As you say. Have you ever done that before, rung the police at sight of what you thought was reckless or dangerous driving?
A few times.
No less than 8 times in the last year and a half.
Oh, I don't know.
Well, would you perhaps look at this newspaper cutting, Mr. Valentine, from the Fulchester Herald? Do you recognize that article?
Yes.
Are the contents of it true?
Yes.
Well, the newspaper article states, does it not, that you are the watchdog of the Walmsley Road. Thank you.
It's a notorious bit of road, is that, sir? Oh, yes, I told them.
Yes. And so you rang the police on the night of May the 8th. Did they send a patrol car?
To me? Not to me.
Oh, now, what did you tell them?
I said, no, look here, lads. I'm sick and tired of doing your job for you. They've been at it again, another couple of lunatics. And I told them the tale. And I told them they'd better get there, quick.
And what did they say to you?
Well, they know me, and they said, it's all right, Arthur. We'll look into it.
Oh, I see. They know you by name at the station, then?
Oh, yes.
Thank you, Mr. Valentine.
Mr. Pennison, how long had you known Walter Demmes?
2 years.
And Peter Tukes?
He was a Sarnie course student.
He was a what?
Sarnie course. Sandwich course.
Oh, I see. Yes. And you were full-time. Were you doing the same course as Demmes?
No, but I knew him since school. His mother was a friend of my mother's.
Yes, I see. Now, let's go back to the night of May the 8th, if we may. There's been a quarrel in the Wellington Inn pub, as we've heard, and you, Tukes and Demmes, go out with the accused right behind you. Is that right?
You know it is.
Answer learned counsel's question properly.
Yes.
Very well. Now, did the accused sound his horn or flash his lights at you at all?
No.
What did he do?
He tried to catch us. He was driving a clapped-out Mini. It was a few minutes before we sussed what he was trying to do.
Yes. Now, where were you sitting in the car?
I was in the back with Tukes, wasn't I? I was the one who was going to get it first.
Yes. Were you afraid?
Wouldn't you be?
How old are you, Mr. Pinniston?
19.
You're giving evidence about a car crash in which one of your friends was killed. What you have to say is of great importance. You're here to answer counsel's questions, not to ask them. Do you understand what I mean?
Yes.
Yes, Mr. Parsons.
Now, Mr. Pearson, you said that you were afraid. What did you see that made you afraid?
He was right on top of us. Never seen him drive like that before. Normally, he's a gutless driver.
Very well. Now, let us come to the events on the Walmsley Road. Now, there's a town end, the dual carriageway there. What happened there?
Well, Wally got onto the Walmsley Road and headed north. He was right behind us. He was driving right up our exhaust, that's all. He hit us. Wally veered and came across. The tyre hit the kerb of the central reservation. He started to lose it.
Yes, but he didn't lose it, did he? What happened?
Well, the machine we was in was going all over the place. Wally was fighting it, and me and Tukes were looking out the back, spotting for Watson.
Mm. So you really expected Watson to persevere?
Well, he was happy, wasn't he? He'd nearly killed us. But we were still there, still going, and he was still right behind us.
Did he make another pass at you?
Oh, he tried, yes. But he wasn't good enough. He went past. Then we got up by some park they have there, and he stood on the brakes right in front of us. I don't know how we missed him. He was a nutter, man. He's got a clear road ahead of him. He's got traffic indicators if he wants to use them. Well, Wally drove up on the pavement and got round. And he's still coming after us.
Yes. And ahead of you was the St. George's roundabout. What happened then?
Well, he was behind us again, trying to clip us. Mm. We were all shouting and that. Then Wally slowed because of the roundabout. And Watson hit us again, really hard. And he lost control.
Yes, and you crashed.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes, thank you, Mr. Peniston.
Mr. Peniston, you say you were terrified. By what? By Mr. Watson's driving?
Yeah.
But Mr. Peniston, there were three of you. The fact is, Mr. Peniston, isn't it, that the reason you didn't tell Dennis to stop was that far from being terrified, you were in fact thoroughly enjoying yourself, weren't you? Dennis had decided to try and dice with Watson, isn't that right?
All we wanted was to get away.
Did Dennis actually use the word dice in the course of the chase?
Not that I heard.
And that last collision which precipitated the crash, that was caused by Dennis, who deliberately cut out just when my client was attempting the process of overtaking, isn't that so?
No, he clipped us.
It all happened very quickly, didn't it?
Yes.
And are you really saying that you, in the back of that car, are able to say which of the two cars veered and caused that last collision?
Yes.
Really? Now, Mr. Watson, will you tell the members of the jury about these three young students, explaining, if you will, your functions in regard to them?
My appointment at Betts Lane College was as grade one lecturer in the Department of General Studies. My lecturing responsibilities were to the full-time students of that department, mostly A-level candidates. Demis and Penistone both came within that bracket. I taught the student Penistone for all aspects of his course and Demis for about half of his. The other student, Tukes, although I'd seen him around the place, well, I hadn't actually taught him.
And will you tell us a little of your duties outside the classroom, aside, shall we say, from talk and chalk?
A place like Betts Lane is teeming with students from 9 o'clock in the morning till 9 o'clock at night. It's big, bustling, and to an outside observer, a bit messy, I should think. There's no corporate life as such. A disco, a library, a bar, nothing much else.
Did you see your job simply to teach your subject for the allotted time and then go home?
Well, because it's such a factory, most of the lecturers felt the need to humanize it in some way. Socializing with the students afterwards, I took the same viewpoint.
Very well. Now, on the night of May the 8th, you and your head of department, Mr. Manning, and Miss Amthill, went to the Wellington Inn to have a drink, and there you met the three young students you mentioned. And almost at once, a violent altercation took place. Will you tell us how that came about?
Demis had just come from the principal's office. Apparently he'd lost his head whilst talking to the principal and foolishly chucked up his place in college. It seemed he wished to blame us for it.
Now, we've heard Demis described as a difficult student. Have you ever used those words to describe him?
He had the knack of taking one to the very edge. He wanted to slug it out with the authorities from the day he registered.
And he'd gone up on report to the principal with notes from all three of you, is that right?
Yes, what a stupid and ridiculous essay that he'd written. You see, a lecturer only has so many hours allocated to him to teach a subject. Now, a student like Demis could disrupt the work of a whole group.
Now, your note to Miss Amthill. This is Carol's golden chance to nail him. What did those words mean?
All I meant was that Carol had a golden opportunity to tie Demis down to a proven case, an essay in his own handwriting. You see, lecturers can't keep running to the principal every time a student has a go at them for personal reasons, as Demis had done with Carol. All I meant was that Carol could bring him to the attention of the principal on unassailable grounds.
And nothing else?
Well, there was no question of Rogers. Principal Rogers, that is. Sacking him just before the examinations. The boy sacked himself.
So that when Demis came into the pub and said, "You've done enough damage for one day, you bastards," you felt the rebuke was ill-placed?
Well, of course it was. When Demis went up in front of the principal, we expected him to get a roasting for bad work and an opinion he might listen to about his chances in the forthcoming examination.
But in the event, things turned out very differently. Now, we've heard evidence about your quickness of temper, Mr. Watson. Have you ever been called to account for that by the college authorities?
No, never.
You consider yourself a good teacher?
I did think so, yes.
Were you ever given a roasting by Principal Rogers?
No, never.
Now tell us, Mr. Watson, how do you measure your success as a teacher?
Well, in a college such as we're discussing, one tends to take the student's measure of success.
Which is?
Good exam results.
And were your results good from year to year?
Yes, they were very favourable.
So that this quickness of temper, this sharpness of approach upon occasion, didn't interfere with your competence and success as a teacher?
Correct.
Then, taking you back to the pub that night, your loss of temper and sharpness of approach to these three students, well, that would be familiar enough, wouldn't it, to Peniston and Tukes? Let me put it this way. Was your attitude to these three young men in any way different to that which you might have adopted in the classroom or the college corridors?
Given the same provocation, no.
Are you saying that such an altercation might have broken out within the college, in the literature classroom?
My lord, further education students are not saints. It's something to try and avoid in a classroom, yes, but it could have happened.
You could have spoken in the same way, with the same heat.
Amongst male students, there is no great respect for polite language, sir. And with Demis in particular, it could have happened anywhere.
And why was that?
Demis was a very difficult personality. I think that would be agreed upon by most of the staff at college, even those who didn't actually teach him. It's called aggro, a kind of pointless aggression.
Oh, is there such a thing as pointless aggression?
Well, my lord, in some cases, the purpose to aggression is very difficult to find. I mean, one tries everything with a student like Demis, you have to, but sometimes you never really find out what exactly it is that's causing it. For example, he hated Carol, and one could say it was because she didn't respond to him sexually. And yet the lad didn't understand that she had no obligation to do so.
Mr. Watson, Carol Abtill, some of your exchanges with Demis were a defense of her, were they not?
Yes, she's very young and very good-natured. Demis was slanging her as hard as he could in public, as loud as he could.
What is slagging her?
Slandering her in front of a bar full of people.
And as we have heard, that involved you directly. Demis had tried to circulate the rumor that you and Miss Abtill were more than good friends.
Yes, well, that's a mild version of it.
And we've heard that he also, in the same context, had made unfriendly remarks about your wife and your relationships with your wife. Did you find that extremely provocative?
The boy said them with such venom. I was... Well, Carol has told you anyway. I was having a difficult personal time at home. Now, in Betts Lane, there are no secrets in a place like that. But Demis was very explicit. I wanted him to shut up. I wanted him to go away. I was ashamed. I was angry. And yes, I was provoked.
And I think I must ask you to tell us what it was he said about your wife that you found so extremely provocative. And I'm very sorry to have to do so.
He said that Sylvia was nothing but the staff mattress.
And what did you understand him to mean by that?
I should think it's clear enough.
When he said that, what did you do?
I told them to get out.
Now, we've heard evidence that you then said, I can't leave it just like this. I am going to finish that bastard. What made you say that?
Well, it was so heated. I'd lost my temper. I mean, there was so much that was wrong with the whole damn business. And least of all, a bar full of people gawking at me, thinking, oh, that's the way it is with him, is it? I just couldn't sit there and pretend nothing had happened. I couldn't do it.
And so you followed them out. What did you then see?
Well, I think I expected to have it out with them, face to face, without being overheard. But they were already in their car. They drove at my car, smashed it, and then drove off.
They drove down the car park, paused, and then rammed your car. Is that right?
Yes.
And then you ran to your car, jumped in and followed them. What did you intend to do?
Well, I wanted to stop them, square things with them.
How?
I don't think I really thought of that at the time.
Now, we've heard of the collision between the two cars. When the two cars touched end to end, was your intention to force Demis off the carriageway?
No, it was not.
Well, what was your motive then?
I was merely playing tit for tat for the damage done to my car.
Did you appreciate the danger of that manoeuvre?
Well, I was merely trying to damage the car, not the driver. I thought I could do it. I mean, after I nudged them the first time and he'd gained control, I overtook and passed them.
But then, at the park entrance higher up, we've heard that you applied your brakes in front of Demis's car.
Yes, that's right.
And then came the collision which caused Demis's car to crash.
Yes. I was overtaking. You see, I was trying to get them to stop, like the police do, edge them into the side of the road, but As I was overtaking, he suddenly veered out, the cars touched, and he lost control. He shunted into me, in fact.
Shunted? Is that a motor racing expression?
Yes, my lord.
And where did you pick that up?
Television.
Yes.
Very well now, Mr. Watson. Let us retrace your steps, just to be sure. Did you at any time intend to injure Demis?
No.
And you say that the first collision was a deliberate action on your part to damage the car that Demis was driving, that you used your judgment, as you put it, to harm the car, but not the driver, but that the last collision was caused by Demis ramming into you?
Yes, that's correct.
Now, what sort of speed were you driving at, the maximum?
Well, 50 or so, I should think.
Not 70?
Well, of course not.
You a good driver, Mr. Watson?
I have a clean license. I'm not a wild or fast driver in the normal sense of the word, far from it.
His lordship has mentioned motor sports. Are you a motor sports fan?
No, I sometimes watch it on a Saturday afternoon, if I mean.
You perhaps belong to a rallying club?
No, I don't.
But you enjoy driving?
No, I don't. It's something I have to do, but I don't enjoy it. I've no real interest in driving as such.
You are perhaps like the rest of us in this court, who do not enjoy driving either as a relaxation or a sport, but cope with a car because we need it for our work.
Yes, if I could do without a car, I would do, certainly.
Yes, yes. And finally, Mr. Watson, I take you back to the scene of the accident. The accident in which Demis was so tragically killed. When his car crashed, what did you do?
Well, I got out of my car and ran up a grass verge towards them. Demis's car was lying on its side. The roof was crushed down at the front, just above the windscreen. I tried to open the driver's door.
Go on.
Yes, I tried to open the driver's door, but it was jammed. I tried to rock the damn thing back on its wheels, but I couldn't. So I ran down to the garage, and there I phoned for the police and the ambulance and returned to the scene of the accident. Some people were coming out of a council estate, and there were some Boy Scouts from a church hall. I really tried to help. I really did try.
Did you know at the time that Demis was dead?
Yes, yes.
How did you know that? I have no further questions of my witness, my lord.
The jury in this case is composed of members of the general public. The Queen against Watson will be concluded tomorrow in the Crown Court. On May the 8th of this year, Bernard Watson, a lecturer at a college of further education, and two colleagues were drinking in a public house to celebrate his promotion when they were interrupted by three students of the college. A violent altercation ensued with one of these students in particular, Walter Demis, who that day resigned his place in the college after being brought to book for indiscipline and unsatisfactory work. When Watson went to the car park to get his car, he saw the students in a car driven by Demis deliberately ram it. A 3.5-mile chase through the streets of Fulchester developed, and at St. George's roundabout, the student's car overturned and the driver, Demis, was killed. On examination of the cars by forensic experts, it was seen that both cars bore evidence of having more than once collided while travelling at speed. As a consequence, Bernard Watson is on trial today, charged with the murder of Walter Demis. Watson has given his evidence in chief. Mr. Parsons, prosecuting counsel for the Crown, rises to cross-examine.
Now, Mr. Watson, do you accept that your driving that night in May was dangerous? and reckless?
Reckless, yes. I now very much regret it.
That is to say, driving around the streets on a May night at something near twice the legal speed limit, bumping another car to repay damage, tit for tat, to use your phrase, driving recklessly without thought for other road users, these things are matter now for regret.
Yes, I have already said so.
Yes. Now, you're an intelligent man, no doubt. You've a university degree.
Two, in fact.
Good. Well, you appreciate, don't you, that when two cars collide at speed, no matter how slight the collision is, there is always a risk of serious injury or death.
Yes.
Yes, and you realized that night as you drove out of the Wellington Inn car park following Demis's car.
No, I didn't.
You didn't? Really? Well, tell me this, then. Was there any time during the chase itself when you had Demis in your sights, so to speak, that you thought to yourself, this is a stupid thing to do?
There was no time to think of that.
No time? Well, what were you doing with the time?
I was driving a car very fast.
Yes, very fast. I see. So, can we say then that from the moment you got into your car and started to follow Demis in his car, you had only time to think about one thing, the job in hand?
That's a deliberate twist on what I've said.
Oh. Well, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Well, you tell us what you mean.
I mean that at that particular moment of time, I didn't think that what I was doing was stupid.
I'm sure you've thought so since. I mean, no doubt you've asked yourself, why didn't I stop? Why didn't I give way and let them pass?
Yes, yes, of course I have.
Yes, well, you must have done. But, why didn't you stop?
Because, as I've already told you, I was angry. I just didn't think about it. I was concentrating.
Oh, you were concentrating? Well, what were you concentrating on?
I was driving much faster than I usually do, at a much greater danger to myself than I'm used to.
Oh, so you recognize the danger to yourself?
Yes.
Yes, and therefore to the others. I mean, we must be quite clear. It was you who was chasing them, and not the other way around.
Thank you for reminding me.
Yes, well, I'm sorry if my questions upset you, Mr. Watson.
They don't, sir.
I'm very pleased to hear it. Now, you were an angry man. You were concentrating and driving very fast. Would it be fair to talk about concentrated anger?
It would be totally unfair. That is an interpretation which the words I've used won't take.
Yes, but you see, we've heard from your testimony and the testimony of the others that the argument in the pub that night which started all this off was, to say the least of it, acrimonious. And we know that, in part for you, it was a defence of your colleague, Miss Amto, and later on, the defence of your wife's good name. Now, you were furious, weren't you?
I was with two colleagues from the college, and we were being insulted and abused by three students from the college in front of a bar full of people. Now, that was the issue.
Yes, well, did you find it difficult to contain your anger?
Yes, yes, yes.
Now, we've heard the expression used of Demis, that he was a troublemaker. Did he cause you much trouble at the college?
No, not me as much as others.
Yes, I see. But you decided before this fateful meeting in the pub that Demis was a troublemaker.
Well, if you had asked me a direct question, I would have answered yes.
Yes, well, that's clear enough. And as we've heard, what was said between you and Demis concerned Miss Amto and your wife, and you, of course, yourself. Now, he was doing nothing if not causing you trouble that night.
Yes.
Yes. And that scene between you and Demis was really some kind of a showdown, wasn't it?
It was the worst row I'd ever had with a student.
Well, yes, exactly. And in fact, you went after Demis with a vengeance, metaphorically in the pub, and physically once you got into this motor car. Now, that would account for your anger and for your concentration, would it not?
When I went after Demis in the car, I wasn't clear what I was going to do, except, well, to bring him to book.
Bring him to book? Yes, precisely. By causing his car to crash.
No, to stop him, yes, to square things with him, yes, but to talk to him, to give him a piece of my mind.
There, I put it to you, Mr. Watson, you had no intention of getting Demis to stop, but instead you slugged it out in these cars, as the evidence suggests. You, a 35-year-old graduate, and here, a 19-year-old student, isn't that so?
No, I'm sorry, it's rubbish.
You see, you tell us you didn't have any time to think about what you were doing, and then you tell us that you were trying to bring him to book. Now, I put it to you that when you followed Demis out of that car park, you were intending to finish it. You were intending to drive your car at Demis's car. And you've told us as much yourself. Only you tried to qualify it by saying that you were driving at the car and not at the driver.
I had no wish to harm the boy.
What? Driving for 3.5 miles through the streets at 60 miles an hour, following Demis or him following you, the cars colliding, and you didn't want to harm him? It is rather say that for 3.5 miles, you were behind the wheel of a car hell-bent on destruction.
No, that's not true.
The truth is that far from wishing to bring Demis to a halt by the side of the road, your wish was quite contrary.
No.
You drove out of that car park, as you say, angry, and with the concentrated mind of a man bent on revenge, a fearful revenge.
No!
I mean, no doubt, in a more rational moment, you might have thought twice before acting so recklessly. But that night, you were in the white heat of a killing mood, were you not?
No, that's just not true!
You see, in all that time, you never once sounded your horn, used your lights, used your indicators in order to get Demis to stop, did you?
I've already said I was intent on catching up with them.
Yes, because you wanted to kill him.
No.
But you must have realized that that might happen.
Not at the time.
After the first collision, Demis's car had gone out of control, had driven onto the central reservation. Are you still saying you were unaware of the potentially lethal effect of any collision?
Well, of
between
course.
Two cars driving at speed?
Yes, then, of
yes,
course, but that's why...
Yes, and then you did it again. Only this time you succeeded in causing the car to crash and Demis to die.
No! I was merely overtaking. He veered into me.
Fact is that Demis goaded you beyond your endurance, did he not?
Yes, I've already admitted that.
You lost control of yourself, and you tried and succeeded in killing him.
Look, I may have lost control of myself, but not to the extent of wanting to murder the boy.
No.
Mr. Watson, in this 3 or 4 minute chase by car, did you have any motive in keeping up the chase after the initial contact, the tit for tat?
Yes, I wanted him to stop.
Why did you not simply stop yourself?
Look, I've already said why. I don't know. I mean, it wasn't what I was going to do to Demis. It wasn't anything like that at all. It was just what had happened. He'd broken the law, I'd broken the law. There'd been this terrible row. They damaged my car. And, well, when you're driving a car that fast, you can't get up and walk around it and think, what am I doing? You can't take your eyes off the road. I don't know why I didn't stop, except it seemed right at the time to go on.
Now, you say it seemed right. Now, would you tell his lordship and the members of the jury quite simply and plainly what it is you mean when you talk about bringing these students to book?
Well, in my judgment, in the few moments I had time to judge in the car park, I knew that it was my duty to do something positive about bringing the whole stupid mess to a proper conclusion. I don't know how I was going to do it, but that was my intention.
And I ask you once more, was the collision at the Red Hall roundabout the result of the action by Demis, or was it a deliberate ramming by you?
No, it was Demis.
Yes. And when you'd finally brought your car to a standstill and you'd got out and run up the hill to the scene of the crash, what were your first thoughts then?
Well, my immediate reaction was that there'd been a ghastly accident.
An accident?
Yes, that's what it was, an accident. It was an accident.
Thank you, Mr. Watson. Does your lordship have any questions?
No. You may return to the dock, Mr. Watson.
Thank you, sir.
Do you have any further witness to call, Mr. Cross?
Yes, my lord. Peter James Tukes, the third student in the car driven by the deceased.
Peter James Tukes!
Religion, are you?
C of E.
You take this Bible in
I
your right
hand? I swear by Almighty God, the evidence I shall give shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth.
You are Peter James Tukes?
Yeah.
And where do you live?
114 Vienna Road, Forchester.
Yes, at the time of these events, a sandwich course student at the Betts Lane College, I believe.
Yeah.
Would you explain just what that means?
Well, I was sent by my firm to the college for a year's course in business studies. When it was over, I was supposed to go back to them.
Thank you. Now, will you describe your achievements in the firm?
Well, I worked for the Electricity Generating Board, was a craft apprentice. This course I was on was the first step up to management.
You've been singled out, therefore?
I suppose so, yeah.
And was this sandwich course examined, and did you pass?
Yeah, it was a college course, like, and I got a distinction.
How did you come to meet the students, Demis and Peniston?
I met them a few times, pubs, up at the college union. They've got a bar there.
Were you fast friends?
Just casual.
Very well. Now, you were a passenger in the car driven by Demis, together with the other student, Peniston. We've heard from Peniston about the car chase through the streets. Would you now tell us what happened from the moment you got into the car with Demis and Peniston?
Well, when we came out of the pub, we were laughing and that, and we got into Demis's car. He came down the car park, saw Watson's car park there, so he slammed it. We had to reverse and go forward a bit, and by the time we came out of the park, Watson was right behind us. Didn't expect that, of course.
And then the chase began. Now, we've heard from Peniston that he was terrified. Were you terrified?
What of?
About anything to do with that ride.
I was laughing too hard.
You were laughing?
Yeah, well, it was very funny.
You mean to say that you were driving through the streets there faster than you should, pursued there by Mr. Watson in his car, and you found it funny?
Well, it was funny. It may not seem like it now, but it was then.
Was it a game or something?
Look, if you bash a bloke's car in, you don't expect him to burst into tears, do you? You expect him to come after you. And when he did, it was funny. Or at any rate, we were laughing.
You were all laughing?
Yeah, to begin with, of course.
Very well. Now, let's go to the bottom of Walmsley Road. Mr. Watson's car touched yours at speed, is that right?
We were dicing, yeah.
You were dicing? What does that mean?
What it says.
Mr. Tukes, did Demis use the word dice or dicing at any time?
Yeah, he said this bastard wants to learn how to dice.
When was that?
Just before Watson hit us.
And when the two cars touched?
The same, he said, bloody hell, he doesn't know how to dice, something like that.
Would you define dicing for us?
Yeah, it's when you get two cars and they take risks. It's like throwing dice, pushing your luck.
You ever seen a dice then?
Yes.
You have first-hand knowledge of it?
I've done it myself.
You've driven a car with the intention of dicing?
It's common enough.
Where was that?
All over, anywhere. You needle a bloke or he needles you and it starts.
And what is the successful outcome of a dice?
You win.
Did you, therefore, use that expression that evening?
Well, I said to Demis, if you're going to dice him, do it.
Oh, was Demis doing something wrong, then?
No, he's just a bit chicken. He had a big mouth. He had a lot of mouth, a nice lad, but a lot of mouth.
You say the successful outcome of a dice is to win. How does one win a dice?
Well, the other guy chickens out. You have to draw him on, play him a bit, make him think he's doing all right, and then you...
And then you what?
Shut him out.
What does that mean?
Well, he either stops, falls over to the side of the road, or gives up. Chicken.
So that when you said to Demis, if you're going to dice him, do it, what exactly did you mean?
Well, I meant get on with it.
Force him to give up? Run him off the road, compel him to stop, is that what you meant?
Yeah.
Did he pay you any heed?
Well, he said he was trying.
When did you say this, and when did he reply?
After Watson clobbered us the first time.
So, that first collision was not a shutout then?
No.
And then Watson passed you and slammed on his brakes?
Yeah.
You avoided him, and then he was behind you again. What did you then say to Demis?
Well, I was shouting, take him.
Take him?
Yeah, get it over with, take him.
And again, did he respond?
Well, he said, all right, all right.
And just before the roundabout?
Yeah, well, that was balmy. We just sort of veered into Watson.
And then the car went out of control, eh?
Yeah.
Now tell me, were you at all surprised at getting into a crash like this after all this hectic dicing, as you've termed it?
Well, I was none too pleased, but I wasn't all that surprised, no.
Because, as I've understood it, Mr. Tukes, your purpose in all this was not to flee from Mr. Watson at any cost, but rather to dice with him, to somewhere or other shut him out, to take him. Is that not so?
Yeah, well, that's what it's all about. That's what all this is about.
Now, Mr. Tukes, it is your evidence that what we had there was a dice.
Right.
Something you're a bit expert in, is that right?
Yeah.
We are to understand that you had prior experience of this enough to give Demis, the benefit of your wisdom.
Yeah.
Yes. Now, it takes two to dice.
Well, it takes two cars, that's obvious.
Well, yes, I meant two like-minded drivers. Suppose I wish to dice with my learned friend, and he immediately draws into the side of the road at the first signs of this, as I trust and hope he would. Is that a dice?
Well, it's not much of one, is it?
No, indeed it isn't, Mr. Duke, you see, because I must understand from what you say that a dice is a continuous activity carried out over a distance with the two participants willing. Otherwise, it's no contest, am I right?
Well, it is a contest, yeah.
Well, yes, it is a contest, a particularly gruesome one, with death and mutilation at every turn. But I gather from your evidence that Demis was an unwilling or chicken contestant. He was not keen, and that is why you told him, if you're going to dice, do it.
Well, I meant get on with it.
Yes, that is to say, get on with it, make it a contest.
Well, stop pansying about, do him.
Yes, because he is trying to do you.
All I wanted was for Wally, Demis, to do better, to push. Wanted him to slam it around a bit. It's not what the other bloke does to you, it's what you do to him. It's not a game of chess or a hand of bridge.
Yes. Now, did Demis appear to pay any attention to you?
Of course.
But we've heard from Mr. Peniston there that he at least was terrified. Was Demis not also terrified?
Demis? Now, Demis was the cockiest kid alive. He was always pushing his luck.
Well, I suggest to you that Demis was just as frightened as Mr. Peniston.
Now, all he thought about was looking good. He knew the way it can go sometimes. Demis tried to be hard all the time.
But you have said that he was taking your advice. He was shouting, I'm trying, and so on.
Yeah, well, he was all right. He bashed Watson's car and you don't expect to get away with that scot-free, do you? All he ever thought about was being a hard man. Anyone will tell you that.
Yes, but I mean, when Demis bashed Watson's car, it was stationary in the car park, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Yes. And would you also agree with me that you were paying particular attention to this dicing?
Yes, I was.
Yes. And you were paying close attention to the position of the two cars?
Yeah.
Yes. Now, just before the last collision, the accused was in the offside lane and you were in the near side lane. Was he keeping correct station in his lane?
No, he was coming at us.
Yes, and you said that Demis was verging towards him.
Yeah.
Yes. Now, can you say in which lane the collision took place? Did Demis cross into the offside lane, or did the accused cross into the near side lane?
Couldn't say.
Well, come now, Mr. Jukes, I mean, you must know. You were paying the utmost attention.
Does it matter?
Yes, young man, it does matter very much. Your friend died.
I'm sorry, but I really couldn't say. And as for Wally dying, I mean, you have to expect it, don't you? I mean, it's feeling around, really. You have to expect the worst. It was rotten, sure, but, well, you have to expect it.
Do you have any feeling at all about the death of your friend?
He's dead, that's all.
Mr. Parsons.
No further questions, my lord.
It is your belief that Watson was dicing that night?
Yes.
An inference you drew from the manoeuvres of his car?
What else?
Of course not. You had no other means of knowing what was in his mind, but the truth is, Mr. Tukes, isn't it, that after that first collision, my client was simply trying to stop your vehicle. Isn't that right?
He was dicing.
Yes. Mr. Tukes, have you lost your post as a result of the publicity surrounding this crash?
No, they can't sack me, but I'm back in overalls here.
Do you have any animosity towards my client?
No.
Do you attribute any blame to him?
No, he drove well.
In this case, as in virtually all criminal cases, the burden lies on the prosecution to prove, beyond all reasonable doubt, each and every element of the offence. Now, the first element that the prosecution must prove is that Demis's death was caused by the deceased. So it must be shown that the clash between the two cars, which resulted in Demis's car going out of control and crashing, was engineered wholly or partly by the accused. Now, the accused would not have caused the death of Demis if, as he claims, he had been, at the time, driving quite properly in the offside lane and the deceased's car swerved or veered out and collided with his. On the other hand, he would have been the cause of Demis's death if the collision were due to the movement of his car into the deceased's car. So unless you're satisfied that Demis's death was caused by the accused, your verdict must be one of not guilty. He's committed no crime at all. Now, for a verdict of murder, it must be proved that the accused had the necessary intent. A killing is murder if the accused intended the deceased to die or suffer serious bodily harm, or if, without actually intending these results, he foresaw that death or serious bodily harm were highly probable as a result of his act. Now, if you don't consider that the accused had the necessary intent for murder, you must nevertheless consider whether he is guilty of manslaughter, in that by driving his car, he caused the death of Demis because his driving was grossly negligent. Or if his driving were not so grossly negligent as to be manslaughter, it was dangerous, so that he committed the offence of causing death by dangerous driving. And no doubt you've heard that in some cases it's possible for your verdict to be decided by a majority, but you must aim to be unanimous. If it should finally become apparent that you're not able to reach a unanimous decision, then it may be that I shall have to give you a direction about arriving at a majority one. But at this stage, you must seek to be unanimous. Now, will you please retire and consider your verdict?
Will the foreman rise? Just answer this question, yes or no. Have you reached a verdict upon which you are all agreed?
Yes.
On count one of the indictment, murder, do you find the accused guilty or not guilty?
Not guilty of murder, but guilty of manslaughter.
On count two of the indictment, causing death by dangerous driving, do you find the accused guilty or not guilty?
Guilty.
Bernard Watson was sentenced to 18 months imprisonment for manslaughter and fined £250 for dangerous driving.